Good morning and welcome to FPC Sharpsville Online. We're glad that you've joined us this morning. So this past Thursday evening, we gathered at Shelter 4 up at Buell Park for a time of worship. These gatherings have turned out to be a lot of fun. Sandy said to me at the beginning of our time, she said, you know, where two or three are gathered. I said, yeah, God is with us. It really has been a special time together. So I want to encourage you, if you are comfortable with gathering with other people outdoors, then come on out on a Thursday evening and join us. We will not be meeting this coming Thursday, but the following Thursday, which I believe is August 6th. Keep your eyes open. We will send out a note regarding that. Now, I don't have an interview for you this morning, partially because last week's interview took so much time and energy. I just didn't have the room for it this week. You know, if you have any ideas for an interview or any questions that you would like to have addressed, we could always invite the pastor back out. Or if you have something that you would like to share with the congregation, then please just give me a call. We would love to interview you. You know, I always have the right to put at the bottom. The interviewee in this interview, you know, yeah, I don't know. Yeah. All right, let's try that one more time. Good morning and welcome to FPC Sharpsville Online. We're glad that you've joined us this morning. So this past Thursday, we gathered once again at Shelter 4 at Buell Park for a time of worship. These events are actually turning out to be a lot of fun. Sandy said to me as we got together, she said, you know, Mike, where two or three are gathered. I said, yeah, God is with us. That's what these moments are turning into. So I would encourage you, if you feel comfortable gathering with other people, especially outdoors, then please come join us on a Thursday evening. We won't be gathering this coming Thursday, but the Thursday after that. I believe it's August 6th. So, yeah, come on out and spend some time with us and with God. Keep your eyes open. We'll send out some information regarding it. Now, I don't have an interview for this week, partially because last week's interview was just so much work and energy that I didn't have anything to give to this week. You know, I want to encourage you, if you have any ideas for an interview or any questions that you would like to have addressed, we could always invite the pastor back for an interview. Or if you have something that you yourself would like to share with the congregation, please just give me a call. I would be happy to sit down with you. If you're ready then, let us turn to God in worship. King David declares, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Let us praise the Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open
Please join me in our corporate prayer of confession. This will be followed by a time of silent confession. Who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Amen. Hear these words from the prophet Isaiah. He was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. People of God, know that in Jesus Christ, you really have been healed and set free. Please join me once again in prayer. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you alone are both our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So this morning, we will begin our journey into Amos. Amos is one of the Old Testament prophets. He lived in the southern kingdom of Judah in the town of Tekoa. But God had called him to go north to the kingdom of Israel. Now, when we think about prophets and consequently prophecy, we often think about it in terms of foretelling or predicting what is to come, which is kind of true. But we can't think of the prophets as if they were Old Testament fortune tellers. These prophets, like Amos, will speak about the future out of a radical encounter that they will have with God. And therefore, the message that they bring is a message that God has intended for his people to hear. Typically, their message is a message of judgment with a little bit of hope sprinkled through it. Kind of like when one of those warning lights on your car's dashboard goes off, warning you that if you don't do something soon, then things are going to go bad, very bad. The problem we run into as we study the prophets is understanding actually how they connect to us. Often we look to the prophets to find something about our future, and most often this involves images of Christ's second coming. And so, this is where we need to be really careful. The prophets were called by God to speak to a very specific moment in time. Most of their oracles pointed to either Israel's exile by the Assyrians or Judah's exile by Babylon. So here's where it gets tricky. Some of these oracles had meaning for their original hearers and then were reinterpreted by New Testament authors 600 or 700 years later. Take, for example, what we find at the beginning of the Gospel of Matthew. Regarding the birth of Christ, Matthew will say, "The virgin will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel." This quote that Matthew has selected comes from the writings of the prophet Isaiah. And here's the whole quote. You see, Ahaz was king of Judah at the time when the king of Aram and the king of Israel decided to march against Jerusalem. Ahaz and everyone in Jerusalem were terrified. In fact, Isaiah tells us that the hearts of Ahaz and his people were shaken as the trees of the forest are shaken by the wind. And so God comes to Ahaz through Isaiah, and he makes a promise. He says this, "The Lord himself will give you a sign," Isaiah tells Ahaz. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel. He will be eating curds and honey when he knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right. For before the boy knows enough to reject the wrong and choose the right, the land of the two kings you dread will be laid to waste." In the original context, this prophecy was meant to bring comfort to Ahaz. But then Matthew will take this prophecy and give it new meaning in light of the birth of Christ. This is something that only the New Testament authors had the authority to do. We do not have that same authority. I cannot redefine Scripture in that way, in the same way that they did. So as we come to Amos, what we will be looking for is the original meaning in the original context. Here's the deal. We are turning to the oracles of the prophet Amos, because even though their message was not directed towards us, there are some great lessons that we can take from them. Amos was speaking on behalf of God concerning where Israel and Judah and other nations were being unjust, were basically falling short of God's expectations. Which means we can take away from Amos what is important to God, what matters most. If God was stepping into history to bring about judgment and an end to the injustices of these nations, then what they were doing must have been pretty far off the mark. Again, when we turn to Amos, what we are listening for is God's expectations of how we treat one another, how we treat our neighbors. That's the whole point of this series. We are listening for what matters most to God. Now, I need to be fully honest with you about something. I don't spend a lot of time looking into eschatology, or the part of theology that is concerned about death and judgment in the final destiny of humanity. I know there are pastors who love to do this. There are theologians that spend a lot of time in the prophetic books looking for clues. But that's not me. Partially because Jesus said, "It is not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority." You know, that was his response to the disciples after his resurrection when they asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel?" And then partially because there really is so much we can learn about God from the Bible that doesn't require us to interpret symbols that at the end of the day are up for debate. My preference is to know Christ so I can do as I have been commanded to do, which is to bear witness to him in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Even though I've never been to Jerusalem or Judea or even Samaria. And I am starting to wonder if Sharpsville would count as the ends of the earth. You guys know I love you and I say that in love. If God's in charge of history, which in today's text we will find out that he is, if God's in charge of history, then why not let God be God so that I am free to do what God has commanded me to do? But again, that's my opinion. Others would completely disagree with me. I say this only so that you know where I am coming from. You know, if you are fascinated by eschatology, then by all means, go ahead and dig into it. It's just not where I put my time and energy. There's a lot more, you know, we can talk about regarding the prophets, but we are going to keep coming back to who the prophets are throughout this entire series, so we will save some of that for later. For today, what I want us to focus on instead is on what matters most to God. That's what we will be looking for as we jump into the book of Amos. You know the saying, don't sweat the small stuff. Well, here's the deal. We aren't going to find small stuff in the book of Amos. Everything we find is going to be big stuff, things we really should be paying attention to. It's also going to be a little bit graphic. So this might be a great time to hit pause on the video and set your kids up with something else to do for the next few minutes. All right, let's jump in. So starting at the beginning once more of Amos chapter 1, verse 1. And actually, you know what? What I might have you do is hit the pause button and go and grab a Bible. It is probably going to be helpful if you follow along with me. Now, Amos is in the Old Testament. That's about all direction I can give you to finding it. What I would encourage you to do is open up your Bible to the index. It will tell you what page to turn to. I'll sit here and wait for you to return. It's the beauty of the pause button, right? Okay, so starting at the beginning, once more. Amos chapter 1, verse 1. The words of Amos, one of the shepherds of Tekoa. The vision he saw concerning Israel 2 years before the earthquake, when Uzziah was king of Judah and Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, was king of Israel. He said, "The Lord roars from Zion and thunders from Jerusalem. The pastures of the shepherds dry up, and the top of Carmel withers." This is what the Lord says. Now let's pause here for a quick moment. That phrase, "this is what the Lord says," points us to the fact that the words to follow will not be Amos's words, but God's. Amos is only the messenger. The message comes from the Lord. Back to our text. "So for three sins of Damascus, even for four, I will not relent." Okay, let's pause here again. So no one seems to know what to do with the phrase, "for three sins of Damascus, even for four, I will not relent." We don't find a list of three sins or four sins in our text. The best idea is that God's patience with sin is running out. I think in the metaphor, what we are seeing is that the fourth sin is the sin that broke the proverbial camel's back. I hope that makes sense. So again, "for three sins of Damascus, even for four, I will not relent, because she threshed Gilead with sledges having iron teeth. I will send fire on the house of Hazael and will consume the fortresses of Ben-Hadad. I will break down the gate of Damascus. I will destroy the king who is in the valley of Avon, the one who holds the scepter in Beth Eden. The people of Aram will go into exile to Kir," says the Lord. Now, Damascus is the capital city of Syria. What we are considering here is that at some point prior to 760 BC, Syria got into a battle in Gilead. And what they did, even in the context of war, was so atrocious that God was bringing judgment out against Syria. The particular battle is unknown, but I want to give you insight into the type of atrocities that Hazael, who is mentioned, will be known for. In the book of 2 Kings, God will instruct Elisha to go to Damascus and to anoint Hazael as king over Aram. Which is interesting because Damascus is in Syria, not in Israel. This very act tells us that God is active in the nations that were surrounding Israel. Here's how the story goes. Elisha is anointing Hazael when he will begin to weep. And he will say to Hazael, I know the harm you will do to the Israelites. You will set fire to their fortified places. You will kill their young men with the sword. You will dash their children to the ground. And you will rip open their pregnant women. You know, Elisha as a prophet saw what was coming, and it brought him to tears because of the type of horror that his zeal will become guilty of. It's bad. So back to the oracle. God is saying through Amos that Syria, under Hazael, so utterly crushed Gilead, it's as if they threshed them with sledges having iron teeth. Now, threshing with a sledge is this process where we take cut wheat and we separate the grain from the stalk. I don't know of many of you who have done this or even have seen it done. So it's a little tricky, I think, to picture what is happening here. Instead, the best thought I came up with was a picture of mortar and pestle. Ours is granite, I think. And what we do is we put sugar and salt into the mortar and then grind it with the pestle into dust so that we can put it on our popcorn. I think the image of threshing that we find here in this oracle is similar to that image of grinding something into dust. God is saying that even in war, how we treat one another has limitations. So God's response, his judgment will be to send fire, which in this reference is not literal, but again, a symbol of how badly the house of Hazael and the fortresses of Ben-Hadad will be consumed. Imagine what it would look like if a fire had torn through a nation. Through Amos, God is coming to Israel and saying, your enemy, Syria, is about to experience my judgment. If you were an Israelite, think about this. How do you think this message would have made you feel? Again, that's the first oracle. What I want you to notice is that it begins with, this is what the Lord says, and it ends with, says the Lord. Amos isn't the one bringing judgment upon Syria. God is. The second oracle. This is what the Lord says, for three sins of Gaza, even for four, I will not relent, because she took captive whole communities and sold them to Edom. I will send fire on the walls of Gaza, and that will consume her fortresses. I will destroy the king of Ashdod and the one who holds the scepter in Ashkelon. I will turn my hand against Ekron till the last of the Philistines are dead, says the sovereign Lord. In this second oracle, what we find is four out of the five main cities of the Philistines, Gaza being the principal city, and then Ashdod, Ashkelon, and Ekron. Gath, for some reason, is not mentioned in this oracle. The repetition of this is what the Lord says, along with three sins of Gaza, even for four, I will not relent, signals to the hearer of this oracle that once again, God's judgment is coming. What you just heard is going to come again. You know, I think we overlook just how important repetition is in capturing our attention. It can set our expectation for what is to follow. The sin of the Philistines is the sin of forced slavery. She took captive whole communities and sold them to Edom. You know, throughout the Old Testament, we find laws that governed slavery. For example, if you owned a slave and you hit that slave, damaging either their eye or their tooth, the slave was to be set free. We find that command in Exodus. And then in the book of Deuteronomy, Israel was told, if a slave, If a slave has taken refuge with you, do not hand them over to their master. Let them live among you wherever they like and in whatever town they choose. Do not oppress them. The laws that govern the practice of slavery were intended to protect those who were most vulnerable. They were intended to protect the slave or the servant. So here's the problem. I want you to listen to these words carefully from the book of Exodus. Anyone who kidnaps someone is to be put to death, whether the victim has been sold or is still in the kidnapper's possession. This law that we find in Exodus demanded that anyone who kidnapped someone and sold them as a slave was to be put to death. Because there are certain types of slavery that were unacceptable even 3,000 years ago. The sin of the Philistines was a forced slavery. They took whole communities captive and sold them as slaves. That is the reason for their judgment. I imagine the Israelites are now cheering. First Syria and now Philistia. I imagine them chanting, "Send the fire." Because you need a deep voice when you invoke God's fury and wrath, right? Again, that's what I imagine. The third oracle begins with verse 9. This is what the Lord says, "For three sins of Tyre, even for four, I will not relent. Because she sold whole communities of captives to Edom, disregarding a treaty of brotherhood. I will send a fire on the walls of Tyre that will consume her fortresses." Tyre has committed the same sins that the Philistines had and is therefore facing the same judgment. Now, here's what's unique about Tyre. While the Syrians and the Philistines were enemies of Israel, the city of Tyre, which is the capital of Phoenicia, the city of Tyre was on friendly terms with Israel, especially back when Israel was still a united kingdom under David and Solomon. And even though there seems to be this treaty of brotherhood with Israel, what God's saying is that's not going to matter. In this case, it doesn't matter who you know. God is not going to overlook your injustice any longer. The fourth oracle. This is what the Lord says, "For three sins of Edom, even for four, I will not relent, because he pursued his brother with a sword and slaughtered the women of the land, because his anger raged continually and his fury flamed unchecked. I will send fire on Teman and will consume the fortresses of Bozrah." Do you notice what is happening? These oracles of God through Amos begin with the nations that were Israel's enemies. And then they moved on to a nation that was friendly toward Israel. And now with Edom, they're going to move even further to a nation that is actually related to Israel, kinfolk. The Edomites are descendants of Jacob's brother Esau. And so here's how their relationship goes. If we go back to the Exodus, there seems to be this conflict brewing between Edom and Israel. Moses is going to be leading the nation of Israel to the promised land, and he will send messengers to the king of Edom. And this is what he says. He says, "This is what your brother Israel says. You know about the hardships that have come on us. Our ancestors went down into Egypt, and we lived there for many years. The Egyptians mistreated us and our ancestors, but when we cried out to the Lord, he heard our cry and sent an angel and brought us up out of Egypt. Now we are here at Kadesh, a town on the edge of your territory. Please let us pass through your country. We will not go through any field or vineyard or drink water from any well. We will travel along the king's highway and not turn to the right or to the left until we have passed through your territory. Sounds like a reasonable request, doesn't it? Well, do you know what Edom's response was? No. You may not pass through here. If you try, we will march out and attack you with the sword. By the time of this oracle, what seems to have happened is their relationship has completely broken down to the point where Edom is pursuing the men of Israel with the sword, and he is killing their women. And Edom's rage and fury are basically limitless. The fourth oracle. Our fifth oracle begins with verse 13. This is what the Lord says, "For three sins of Ammon, even for four, I will not relent, because he ripped open the pregnant women of Gilead in order to extend his borders. I will set fire to the walls of Rabbah that will consume her fortresses amid war cries on the day of battle, amid violent winds on a stormy day. Her king will go into exile, he and his officials together, says the Lord." Ammon is another nation that is related to Israel. Ammon had descended from Abraham, was descended from Abraham's nephew Lot. It's actually a sordid story where Lot's younger daughter will get Lot drunk and then sleep with him. And she will give birth to a son whom she will name Ben-Ammi, and he will become the father of the Ammonites. Once again here, we find this graphic image of pregnant women being ripped open. It must have been one of the common practices during war that had occurred. Our sixth oracle will be against Moab. Like Ammon, Moab was Lot's son through Lot's older daughter. This is what the Lord says, "For three sins of Moab, even for four, I will not relent, because he burned to ashes the bones of Edom's king. I will send fire on Moab that will consume the fortresses of Kerioth. Moab will go down in great tumult amid war cries and the blast of the trumpet. I will destroy her ruler and kill all her officials with him, says the Lord." The sins of Moab seem to be in some way the desecration of the dead. This is all kind of crazy stuff, isn't it? So here are a couple of key takeaways before we move on to our seventh oracle. First, God is the God of all creation. He is the God of all nations. He is aware of what nations are up to, and he will respond to their injustices. You know, nations may call on other gods, gods that they have fashioned, but there really is only one God, and he is Lord over all. The point is, God's in control. Not simply of Israel's future, but the future of all nations. And at the end of the day, all nations will be held accountable. Which is why our witness to all nations is so important. You know, as we talked about last week from the book of Jonah, God is gracious and compassionate. He is slow to anger and abounding in love. He is a God who relents from sending calamity, but he will only do this for so long because he has to respond to the injustices of this world. That's what his holiness declares. That's the first takeaway from these oracles. God is in control. The second takeaway from these oracles is that God is actually what God considers to be unjust. With Syria and Edom and Ammon, we see a brutality in war that goes beyond what you would expect on a battlefield. The killing of children, the tearing open of pregnant women, these are unjust practices. There is definitely a sense that not all is fair in love and war, which is why there are certain ethical questions that as Christians we need to ask regarding war. Is torture acceptable in war? What do we do with those we have taken as prisoners? And is collateral damage okay? You know, these are tough questions that we really need to wrestle with. And then with regards to the Philistines and Tyre and Phoenicia, we see that the kidnapping and selling of communities into slavery is unacceptable, which means that the slavery that America participated in historically was actually worthy of God's judgment. And then finally, with Moab, is this desecration of the dead. God is saying, I will not tolerate these injustices forever. I will be judge. Now, there's one final oracle I want to read for this week, and it's our seventh oracle. It begins in chapter 2, verse 4. This is what the Lord says, for three sins of Judah, even for four, I will not relent, because they have rejected the law of the Lord and have not kept his decrees, because they have been led astray by false gods, the gods their ancestors followed. I will send fire on Judah that will consume her fortresses of Jerusalem. The seventh oracle involves Judah, Israel's sister nation. Israel had been one nation under Saul and then David and Solomon. It wasn't until Solomon's son Rehoboam became king that the nation was split into the northern kingdom, which kept the name Israel, and the southern kingdom, which took the name Judah. Judah's sins were not against other nations, but against God. They had rejected the law and its decrees and had followed other gods. Seven oracles, seven nations, all surrounding Israel. With each oracle, God's judgment is getting closer and closer and closer to the nation of Israel. So here's what I want you to think about. Imagine this. Israel is listening to these oracles from Amos, and they are celebrating God's coming judgment upon the nations all around them. I believe that they would have listened to the words of Amos with great joy. This coming day of judgment was something that they had been looking forward to. What I want you to do is picture that moment when your team is about to win and their arch nemesis is about to get theirs. Or picture that moment when someone goes speeding by you on the highway only to get pulled over a mile down the road and they're about to get theirs. Or picture the movie villain being defeated right in the middle of his evil monologue. Ha ha, gotcha. And he gets his. That's what Israel was feeling as they listened to these words from Amos. But this is only the beginning of his oracles. You're going to have to come back next week to see where they go from here. So let's pray. Lord, we are not immune from the injustices of this world. But I pray, I ask that you would give us the eyes to see those injustices from those who are being unjustly treated. Give us the perspective of the oppressed, not the oppressor. To you, we give all praise, honor, and glory. Amen. Please join me as together we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power in the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. And now for our benediction. May God bless you and keep you. May God smile upon you. May God look you full in the face and make you prosper. Amen. Thank you for joining us this morning.